We've all built trading systems that way. There was a market we wanted to trade, so we picked a time frame that we liked and we randomly slapped a trading indicator on it, or two, or three, and then we started tweaking the parameters until past results looked like we found the holy grail. So on we went with those specific parameters, it worked for a few days, and sure enough, before we knew it, that trading system turned into a total dumpster fire, piling up losses after losses. And so on we went to repeat this hopeless process again and again, with nothing else to show for it but time and dollars wasted. So to finally break that vicious cycle of aimless endeavors, today we're going to identify the common system design flaws that lead to failure, and especially what to do differently to put you on the path of success, building robust and lasting trading edges. Let's get it. Coming to quantitative trading means crossing the point of no return for most traders. The scientific appeal of objective decision criteria, testable performance, rule-based emotionless execution consistency, and the sheer reduction in stress that comes with it makes it an all-around superior approach to any other type of analysis. Quantitative trading does come across as a major step up to cursorily looking at a few price action candles or interpreting a company's news flow as a way to make sound trading decisions. But quantitative trading also has its own flaws when done the wrong way. Flaws that may not only lead to random outcomes like traditional methods, but also to downright disasters with systems that will turn on you upon implementation. The democratization of soft coding platforms such as TradingView SpineScript sure did open up retail to systematic trading, and this is a good thing. But has it unlocked the expected benefits of this trading discipline? Sadly, in most cases, it hasn't. Handing you over a weapon does not mean that you will become lethal. Likewise, coding provides zero guarantee that you will perform. So before we jump to what should be done in designing a system, allow me to expose the three crucial ways that most are getting it wrong when building theirs quantitatively. First, in a quasi-Pavlovian type of reaction, most aspiring traders rush head down to their library of indicators and start randomly slapping them on their chart without knowing or being able to articulate why they specifically picked this one over another, and what exactly their preferred indicator really is describing from a mathematical standpoint. There is indeed this preconditioning that quantitative trading should necessarily mean using visual indicators when it shouldn't. There are other ways to recursively quantify and model historical data, and most of these other ways involve simple computations that can be taken care of in a mere spreadsheet or a few straightforward lines in Python. Second, the visual appeal of this over-reliance on indicators often leads traders to cursorily test by hand what trades the indicator would have generated in the recent past. The problem with this approach is twofold. A, your brain will often subconsciously overlook those trade examples that generated losses, and B, there is nothing scientifically proven when such verification applies to only a very limited sample of trades that are not statistically significant. But most importantly, the third most common flaw happens whenever coding is involved. In most cases, it never takes long before beginner traders pile up a towering stack of parameters in their system, whether that is by way of indicators or other criteria. Obviously, the intentions are good. They want their system to look great historically, but this intuitive yearn for picture-perfect backtests is also wrong from a scientific viewpoint, because it inevitably leads the trader to rush to optimization as the core basis for his entire analysis, when optimization should only come as a marginal last step, a last step that may in fact not even be needed as we'll see it later on. In most cases, relying on optimization will lead to overfitting and to the system slumping or even crashing down as soon as it is released in the real world. There is a cure to these common flaws. It is not an easy one, but it can be summarized with the following sentence. Your system design needs to understand and capture the price motion dynamics of the market that you intend to trade. To make this concept easier to grasp, allow me to ditch the quantitative jargon for now and make use of the following analogy. Imagine that you intend to track a bear on a hunting trip. By transposing the flawed logic described earlier over to our hunting analogy, we can assume that what most people would do to find the bear is to go to the store and then buy a trap, bait, a net, a radar, a heat-seeking device, a drone, a tape recorder playing noises of distressed animals, and then even study the moon cycles to correlate them with bear appearances. Because why not? Blindly throwing everything at it but the kitchen sink and see what sticks is basically what they would do. To top it off, they'd only test their hunting method on just a couple of trips. Now, if you think this is an absurd way of approaching the issue, please realize that most traders are not applying any other logic to their work. All that they subconsciously look for is the instant gratification of a result that looks and feels good, without thinking about the deeper implications drawn from logical relevance and robustness. To make the matter worse, the probability of getting lucky in this example, meaning being able to spot the bear by using a boneheaded method, is not null. And whenever that happens, it won't be long before the user starts dreaming up causation when there merely was just a lucky correlation, one that will only rarely work out in the future, or not at all. So if you get my drift, what you will realize with this analogy is that the best way to track the bear is to study first the behavior of the animal, what it likes to eat, where it settles at different times of the day, depending on the weather, the location of its favorite food source, its mating season, etc., etc. In other words, we would want to know the underpinnings that drive the motion dynamics of its average path, as well as what makes it deviate from it and the normalized scope of such deviations. Do you see what I'm getting at? I hope you do, because this is the only way to design a robust system. You need to understand how your market moves at the mathematical level before you even start coding or doing anything that resembles modeling a strategy. Likewise, failing to wrap your head around that concept is the root cause that leads most trading, quantitative or not, to eventually fail. And at the point of failure, this is where you will consistently hear the same excuse, with traders shifting the blame on the fact that somehow the market has changed. How many times have you heard that typical BS? Going back again to our hunting analogy now, asserting that you failed because somehow markets have changed makes as much sense as the hunter claiming that using moon cycles to predict the path of those bears stopped working because bears must have changed, right? Obviously, bears never changed. It is only that the lucky one or two times that moon cycles did align with your bear path created a correlation that led you to assume causation, when in reality, moon cycles never had any predictive power whatsoever on them. It might sound trivial to say it like that, yet this happens to be no more trivial than the exact same flawed logic that is most commonly found in explaining away systematic trading failure. So now we've plotted the root cause of failure, what are the prerequisites that will maximize the relevance, performance, and long-term robustness of your systems? Let me introduce you to the quantitative quadrant that I apply to any of my systems throughout the designing stage. This quadrant is nothing more than a screening mesh that should skim out most of those glaring quantitative biases and statistical artifacts that are most responsible for failed trading systems. As you will see, this mesh is very tight, and chances are that out of the four criteria that compose it, your systems will likely not even pass one or two. And this is expected. Most of retail has never been taught anything else. I started like this too, so please don't beat yourself or despair over it. The quadrant of your system's architecture is comprised of motion dynamics, parametric density, transitivity, and statistical load. Let's go over these one by one, shall we? First and foremost, motion dynamics. Given what we just discussed, how pivotal and imperative this requirement is should be clear by now. There is simply no building a perennial trading system without its rules capturing the very drivers that deterministically influence the movements of its underlying asset's price. And there is no capturing those until after you understand such motion at the mathematical, causational level. This notion is what the true price motion dynamics framework describes in the FX physics ecosystem. It is the basis for the quantitative engine of all trading systems. Discovering and itemizing the characteristics of price motion for a given asset involves such aspects as drift, momentum, memory, symmetry, probabilistic term structure, volatility density, time-weighted bias, etc. This background work is essential because, one, it narrows down the implementation of modeling efforts only to what works, as opposed to randomly slapping indicators at a chart. Two, it meaningfully drives research costs down as far as hardware usage, man hours, and scope of required data. And three, it provides an insurance against future performance decay by making sure that the resulting model is grounded in lasting mathematical reality, as opposed to resting on shaky statistical artifacts. And if we bring it all down to a beginner level quantitative system, using true price motion dynamics would relieve the trader from being puzzled as to why it is, for example, that moving average crossovers can be made to work to some extent on equities, but that they just won't work at all on Forex. This is not by chance. There are very foundational, price motion based underpinnings as to why that is, and not understanding or overlooking the why altogether is the very reason for most quantitative traders failing in their endeavor. Comprehending motion dynamics solves that. Second, parametric density. The second hurdle is very important and should be taken care of once you got your price motion dynamics right. As we will see it in the next episode, using reliable math as the basis for your system architecture is not only the cure for brute force modeling, aimless optimization, and curve fitting in general, it should also entirely substitute itself to it. In practical terms, you will be able to witness two positive outcomes which are likely to be radically different from what you have been experiencing so far. First, your system should work with very few degrees of freedom, meaning parametric inputs, like 2 or 3 maximum. This level of downstream simplicity is only possible if sophistication was taken care of upstream by way of mathematics as we just described. Requiring only a limited amount of moving parts provides the advantage of making your system vastly less prone to degenerating long term. And second, your system should be expected to work with most parametric values, something like 80% plus. This alone is a dead giveaway that you stroke gold as far as mathematical relevance. It also readily cures the need for optimization as the basis for system design. Overall, what you get is an elegantly compact system which profitability is very dense and stable across a wide array of parametric values. When you think about it, this state of algorithmic design is 180 degree opposite to what most retail is doing by way of always more parameters, scattered native performance, and abused optimization which all result in the same algorithmic weakness. The third test in our screening mesh is transitivity. What the heck is that? Well, just like parametric density, it ties right in with your system making sense mathematically. Transitivity implies that when ported to another instrument within the same given asset class, your system should be seamlessly transposable, meaning that it should retain its broad performance characteristics without having to modify its core logic or even radically change its parametric values. The only adjustment to be made from instrument to instrument should in fact remain marginal by way of merely adjusting for volatility, which itself should be performed using multiples of your initial parametric values. Brushing over this concept this quickly is really not doing it justice though, because it flies in the face of the widespread belief that markets somehow change and that systems are doomed to go bad over time no matter what. Once again, guys, this belief of supposedly changing markets is wrong. If your system fails, it is not that the laws of gravity suddenly turned on you. It is that one way or another, you used nothing but underlying optimization to build it in the first place, and that reality simply caught up on you. In other words, you got lucky for a bit, but your system really never worked. When built on sound mathematical grounds, the only aspect of a system that varies over time or across instruments of the same kind should be volatility. Unless some massive regulatory change comes to disrupt and reshape free market dynamics, price formation, when left to its own volition, does not change over time. Only the scale of its formation does. That is why cross-instrument portability within the same asset class is a mere quantitative question, not a qualitative one. Imagine that you built a system on Eurodollar that checks all 4 quadrants. Then the only thing to adjust in order to port it to pound-yen, for example, should be the volatility used to calibrate how other parameters interact with one another. In other words, dialing your multiples of a standard deviation or an ATR as you see fit should suffice. You should not have to change anything relating to the actual code logic. One would not have that luxury with a system grounded in optimization, simply because it would never actually capture the price motion dynamics of currencies to start with. Therefore, it could not be exported and transposed as is to pound yen by merely solving plus or minus for some volatility. You would have to rebuild it from the ground up. That's how you should know to be wary of those systems built specifically for one single instrument. This screams failure from the get-go. The fourth and last item in our quadrant is that of statistical load. This one is very controversial, but as with anything else, there is a mathematical truth to it. The test that your system needs to pass here is that of demonstrating true robustness across the data that you throw at it. Most traders are polarized between those who test on the little data at their disposal versus those who own more data, but swear by testing on a limited sample before so-called validating their backtest on out-of-sample data. The fact of the matter is that neither of these approaches make any sense. The first approach is evidently wrong most of the time. In the best case scenario where traders actually take the time to quantitatively test their ideas, they do so by using a handful of years, meaning a limited amount of volatility regimes, and a ridiculously low amount of trades, sometimes barely reaching the hundreds, in order to validate their system. This is obviously insufficient by all statistical standards and cannot possibly be claimed to prove a system's worth. The second approach is sneakier, because the in-sample, out-of-sample logic provides a sense of sophistication that actually hides the mathematical irrelevance of those systems that use this method as a way of validation. Think of it like this. The only reason that you would consider in-sample out-of-sample to work is that you believe that optimization is a valid way to design a system. Your logic is that if your system works within your sample indeed, then its profitability should hold outside of that sample without changing the parametric values, and that alone would be proof that your system is valid. That sounds sensible at first glance, except that it computes as a circular reference that is void of any logical validity. By using the in-sample out-of-sample method, you are doing nothing more than addressing the output of your system and claiming that it somehow validates the input. And that very logic further opens you to the very real risk of a lucky outcome confirming your initial design, no matter how intrinsically flawed it is. This is especially true when your in-sample out-of-sample data batches are consecutive, meaning that the likelihood of algorithmically hitting the bullseye within a specific market phase is contaminated by the fact that the very next or preceding market regime does not change your data in a material way across all samples. Using a boating analogy, for example, using in-sample out-of-sample this way would be equivalent to tasting a new ship in the calm waters of different ports within the same geographical region. The likelihood of said ship doing fine in all ports is very high. Yet you would believe that because different ports were used for testing, then it would mean that the ship must somehow necessarily be seaworthy. So you start sailing it, and then you steer it to a wholly different geographical region where waters and currents are on a whole nother scale. And before you know it, the ship sinks on you. That is more or less the way the in-sample out-of-sample method is applied in most cases. The truth is that they do not provide any real validation of anything other than confirming the bias implied by the data on which the initial model was built. So what should we do instead? Well, for the third time, this ties right in with the first item of our quadrant, which is that if math was taken care of from the groundwork, then there should be no concern to have about having to resort to any trickery to organize your data in any way that would somehow magically validate your system. Instead, the only thing that matters as far as data management and testing are concerned is both simple and hard or costly to achieve most of the time. It is to increase the statistical load as much as you can and possibly to an extreme in order to maximize the relevance of the test. In other words, more data over more time is always better, and there never is enough of it. Your job is to gather as many reliable data points and years worth of a given instrument's price data as possible in order to both raise the statistical significance of your test and fireproof your systems across the widest array of market regimes. Then you should use 100% of that data to test your system without leaving anything for out of sample and whatnot. Use all of it. To give you an idea of the scale that I am talking about, my trading algorithms typically rely on at least 5,000 trades for systems and up to 120,000 trades for entire portfolios across roughly 35 years worth for stocks and forex and up to 100 years for such assets as commodities. That's a crap load of data points and trades. Costly to acquire, painstaking to curate, and often hard to compile, maintain, and model. But it is the right price to pay if you really want to ensure that your systems do make sense and will be generating sustainable profit for years to come. One last time, take care of the math first, then use all of your data to validate it second. No need to reinvent the wheel here. You just need to use common sense, work smarter, and stop looking for shortcuts. Next up will be a practical example to explore the relevance of this process and to gauge how all of these principles fit in real-life trading system design. So make sure you got the material in this video down and buckle up for some action in the next episode. Stay sharp, everyone.